Hey, this is Dr. Brian Adkins. Again, as promised, I want to go over some questions with you, show you exactly what we do and how it works. But with my TEAS test prep course, as I've been doing from day one, it's all live. It's online. You can hear me. I can hear you. You can see me. I can see you. And you can ask questions in real time. Any question you have, I guarantee you I can answer. Right? We talk about the whys and the hows, how to understand it, how to avoid the traps and the hurdles when it comes to doing well with the TEAS test. Because ultimately, my goal is the same as your goal, which is to get into nursing school. All right. So I want to make sure that you get into nursing school, but not just get in. I want to make sure that you stay in. So with our course, my clients have access to my classes, which are live every Sunday and every single Wednesday for a whole year. So you have access to the course for a whole year where you can do the classes and redo the classes to make sure that you master it, you know it, you understand it. There's no other company, no other tutor out there who's going to do this for you. My goal, again, is the same as yours, to make sure that you understand it, you master it, you know it, you obviously go into the TEAS test and do well. Let's take a look at a couple questions here from our TEAS mastery quiz, okay? So let's go over it together. Here we have our first question, cardiovascular question, actually. And so you can take a look at, if you can't see it on the whiteboard here, you can take a look at the one that you printed out there. But proper blood flow through the circulatory system. So do you know, number one, do you know the flow of blood through the circulatory system? Have you mastered it? What's on the right? What's on the left? What comes, what goes, right? And so with the proper blood flow through the cardiovascular system, this is definitely contingent upon maintaining correct pressure differentials, right? Has your AMP teacher taught you about that? If they have, let's talk more about it, all right? So, under normal circumstances, which of the following is true, right? This is what they'll do on the test. Is this true or is that true, right? And so it's not just fill in the blank. It's not just you know, one word, multiple choice. It's you got to understand what the concepts. And so we'll talk about that. We'll go through and make sure you know that you know that you know it in and out, out and in, all right? And so which of the following is true regarding pressure in the cardiovascular system? And what is pressure? I even give that to you in the question here. So what is pressure? Pressure is force per unit area, right? So force per unit area. And so if you have a large area and a small force, low pressure. The problem in the cardiovascular system is a lot of times you have high pressure over a small area. That's where you get into trouble. Okay, that's when you get into high blood pressure and things like that. We'll explain that a little bit more. All right, but under the circumstances of high pressure in the pulmonary circulation, will that result in high pressure in the right ventricle? Is that true or is that not true? Let's talk about it. The second answer choice B here. So low pressure in the pulmonary circulation, okay, will result in high pressure in the right ventricle. Is that true or is that not true? Let's talk about that. But we'll go through more of these answer choices, but let's actually go ahead and take a look at the heart here and make sure we understand. All right, so we have the lungs, we have the heart, we have some tissue here, so let's definitely fill this in. So we have three sources of blood coming into the heart. So we have the superior vena cava up here. All right, so you have the superior vena cava. We have the inferior vena cava. We also have the CS, which is the coronary sinus. And so that is blood coming from the heart itself, okay? So then it goes into the right atrium. And so the right atrium here, okay? And so past the what? So then it's gotta pass what before it gets to the right ventricle? Right, so the TV, the tricuspid valve, right? So the tricuspid valve, okay, so good. And so once it's in the right ventricle, then it will be expelled into the pulmonary artery. So arteries leave the heart, veins come to the heart. Doesn't matter what it's carrying. So arteries leave the heart, veins come to the heart. And it has to pass the pulmonary valve here. And then ultimately goes into the lungs. Okay? And so into the lungs. And so at the lungs is where you have the alveoli. So alveoli. And so the alveoli is where gas exchange happens. So gas exchange happens. Okay, and so it's literally like a one cell layer thick where the oxygen goes in, goes past these different layers and then into the red blood cells. And so the red blood cells are there, the alveoli are there, they're touching like literally one two cell layer thick, and then the oxygen diffuses across and the carbon dioxide diffuses in the other direction. And so basically into the airspace and out of the body. And so where oxygen comes into the airspace and crosses over the lipid barrier and into the red blood cells, okay? And so the alveoli also have surfactant, or the lungs have surfactant.
And so the surfactant is like an oily substance. And so anytime you have moving parts, especially things that are inflating and deflating as such, then you need some type of oil to decrease the surface tension. And so if you don't have enough surfactant, then the then you don't have enough oil for the inflation and deflation. That's going to cause tension. If you have too much tension, that's going to cause the alveoli to rupture. The alveoli is surface area for gas exchange. If you lose alveoli, then you're losing surface area for gas exchange. So that's what happens when you have smokers and they smoke for a long period of time.
They ultimately develop vascular changes as a result of the inflammation and inflammatory processes that happen as a result of the components of the cigarette smoke. And so with these vascular changes, it causes thickening of the vessels within the lungs, and ultimately leads to pulmonary hypertension. And so that pulmonary hypertension ultimately leads to diseases like COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and the ensuing disease of emphysema. And so losing a lot of the surface area for gas exchange, and certainly causing the inflammation and the chronic bronchitis within the lungs. That is very bad for you. So if you're wondering why your patients who have COPD are walking around with portable oxygen tanks, this is why.
Okay, and so so obviously we don't want that, okay? All right, so so with that, we're then gonna go from the lungs, and so if we go back to the heart, we're going back to the heart from the lungs via the pulmonary veins, okay? So pulmonary veins, okay? So PV, okay? And so so with that, it then goes into the left atrium, from the left atrium to the left ventricle. And so that's going to be past the mitral valve or the bicuspid valve, so BV, right, bicuspid valve or mitral valve, okay? Okay, and then through the aortic valve here, okay, and so ultimately into the aorta, okay? And so we then get the subclavian, brachiocephalic artery, you know, other ones like that. And then ultimately goes down the aorta, okay? So down the aorta, and so into the smaller arteries and arterioles, all right, makes sense? And so ultimately we have the smaller arteries and arterioles, the bifurcations here, and so we'll call this an artery, okay? And so then we have the arterioles, okay? And then ultimately we have here the capillary. And so the capillary is where we have gas exchange. So gases are exchanged, right? So gases exchange, but also nutrient exchange as well. So nutrient exchange as well. And so then we have the venules, right, to the veins, and ultimately to the IVC, the SVC, and the coronary sinus, okay? And so, okay. So with that, we also have the lymphatics. And so lymphatics are going to absorb extracellular fluid. So these are the lymphatics here, so the green here. And so they're going to absorb extracellular fluid. Okay. And so with that, we have, for example, here we have a lymph node. And so the lymph node, okay, is where you have T cells. And so the cytotoxic T cells, or the B cells, are hanging out in these lymph nodes. And they're going to sense anything that comes past them. And so any viruses or bacteria or tumor cells or something like that, so if it comes past it, it's going to try and mount a very aggressive immune response and keep it at bay, right? So it doesn't go into the rest of the body somewhere else. All right, makes sense? All right, so good, good.
All right, so we're back. So you had an opportunity to take a look at the cardiovascular system and understand the flow of blood from the heart into the aorta, down through the thoracic aorta, down to the abdominal aorta, down to the lower extremities, right? And certainly ultimately to the tissues. And so where you have the gas exchange and the nutrient exchange, but also the waste and delivery of waste from the cells into the bloodstream, into the venules, ultimately to the veins, and then to the IVC, the SVC, and the coronary sinus. Okay, so we understand the flow of blood, but do we understand the pressure and the pressure differentials when it comes to all of this? Okay, and so with that, where is the pressure coming from? So when we talk about blood pressure, the systolic blood pressure, where is this pressure coming from? Well, it's coming from the pump. What is the pump? The heart. Okay, and so the heart, especially the left ventricle, is sending the blood out of the heart with that much systolic force. And so normal blood pressure is supposed to be less than 120 over 80, right? And then we get above that, and we get into pre-high blood pressure, pre-hypertension, okay? And then, of course, over 130, high blood pressure, okay? But certainly, when we talk about 180s and 190s and 200s and 210s in terms of systolic number, that is the force that the heart is pushing the blood with that much force, okay? So with that, when we talk about high pressure in the pulmonary circulation, that may come from some type of obstruction in the pulmonary circulation. So if you do have obstruction in the pulmonary circulation before it even gets to the left ventricle, right, before it gets to the left atrium and then to the left ventricle, so if you have high pressure in the pulmonary circulation, let's say, for example, you have a PE. Anyone know what a PE is, right? So we talk about DVD to PE, right? So if you're on long plane trips, you don't want to sit down for too long, right? Get up and walk around. Why do they say that? Right? And so a DVT to a PE. So what that is deep venous thrombosis that ultimately leads to a PE, a pulmonary embolus. And so pulmonary embolus means a blood clot in the lungs. And so if you have a blood clot in the lungs, that's going to create high pressure in the lungs. Okay? And so that will kill you. Okay? And so with that, if you do have some type of obstruction in the lungs, for example, that's creating pressure in the lungs. If you create pressure in the lungs, then that will then force the heart to have to pump against that pressure, right? And so that means that the blood is coming from the right ventricle going into the lungs, and therefore that's going to lead to an elevated right ventricular pressure. If you have high pressure in the pulmonary circulation, that's going to lead to a higher pressure in the right ventricle. Make sense? Okay? And so you got to understand the flow of blood, you got to understand pressure, you got to understand a lot of different things when it comes to being able to answer these questions on the TEAS or the HESI exam. It's not just regurgitation. It's not just flashcards and memorization. So you need someone who understands it, who has mastered the concepts and can explain the concepts to you in a way that will help you to understand it, to be able to apply it, not just memorize it, right? It shouldn't go in one and out the other. You should be able to apply it. And so that's what we're talking about. So when we talk about these questions, it's all about application. It's all about understanding. It's all about making sure that you've mastered the concepts so that you can go into the TEAS test or the HESI exam and get your score into the 80s and 90s and ultimately get that acceptance letter like so many of my other students, okay? And so with this, the correct answer to this question then is what, okay? So high pressure in the pulmonary circulation will ultimately lead to high pressure in the right ventricle. So we're talking answer choice A here. So answer choice A is the correct answer here. This is consistent. And so if you have high pressure in the lungs, then where is that blood coming from? That blood is coming from the right ventricle. And so therefore, if you have high pressure in the lungs, that's going to ultimately lead to high pressure in the right ventricle. That is answer choice A. If you have low pressure in the lungs, no problem. The right ventricle can pump against that low pressure and easily force blood into the lungs. That is what we would normally want. That's what we want normally. We don't want a high pressure in the lungs, right? Because that creates an obstruction and a challenge for the right ventricle, right? We don't want to have an enlarged heart, right? And so the heart is a muscle. And if you put more force, more weight against that particular muscle, so more afterload is what we call it, so more afterload, that's going to force that muscle to work harder, and that ultimately that muscle gets bigger. If the heart gets bigger, then that becomes a problem, okay? So that gets into a whole nother lecture. We'll talk about that next time, all right? So the thing is that if you have high pressure in the portovenous system, that's not going to create greater blood flow coming from the gastrointestinal tract. That's going to create less blood flow coming from the gastrointestinal tract. And so that also becomes a problem as well, especially with patients who have liver cirrhosis, for example, right? And so this becomes a problem. So that's why you see ascites with patients who have liver cirrhosis, okay? Ascites, okay? This is an application right there. Differentials and pressure. Okay, so you got to understand the basics in order to get up to that next level of application. So that's what this is all about. Okay, all right, so great. Hopefully this was a great opportunity for you to review the cardiovascular system, to understand how this all interplays with one another, the important components of the cardiovascular system, right? We talked about the valves and the veins. You need to know that, right? We talked about surfactant. You need to know that, right? We talked about the flow of blood through the heart. You need to know that. We talked about what happens at the capillaries, okay? So you have the alveolar capillaries, but also the tissue capillaries. That is where gas exchange happens. Doesn't happen in the arteries. Happens in the capillaries. Make sure you know that, because they're going to ask you about it, right? And so make sure that you understand exactly how the cardiovascular system works. It's going to be very important to make sure that you do well when it comes to the TEAS test, the HESI exam, the NCLEX exam, but certainly your anatomy and physiology class as well, okay? And so definitely subscribe to our YouTube channel. You want to see more videos like this? Let me know what you want me to go over. I'm happy to go over concepts that are challenging, concepts that you really want to know about, concepts that are somewhat hard to understand. I'm happy to break it down to you, make it easy for you, and help you to understand the clinical application to it as well. That's what we do here at the Adkins Academy. Love to talk to you more. Feel free to reach out to us, 301-960-4950. Would love to talk to you personally about how we can help you to get past the TEAS test and get into nursing school so you can get your RN so you can take advantage of some of those travel nursing jobs. Awesome, awesome, awesome opportunities there. Okay, so definitely like this video, but also subscribe to our YouTube channel, and you'll get notifications for more videos just like this. We'll see you next time. Take a look at some of the reviews that my students leave. All right, thank you.